We're ready for our last panel, so please take your coffee. Okay, folks. There we go. Please find your seats. Please mute your cell phones. Please return your trays to an upright and locked position. Okay, so we're going to start our last panel. It's been a great day so far here at the Knight Civic Hall Symposium on Tech, Politics, and the Media. Again, just a reminder, if you're following along on Twitter, you want to join in the conversation, use the hashtag KFCivicHall. Given the Knight Foundation's long engagement with and involvement in supporting the press as a vital institution in our country, as well as our longstanding interest at Personal Democracy Forum and how people participate in the process as fully as possible, it seems really fitting that we should end today with a panel looking at the First Amendment, freedom of speech, freedom of the press, and prospects for the near future. And I'm going to let our moderator, Chris Hughes, introduce the panel. We have a really esteemed panel here to join us. Let me just say that Chris has been a longtime member of the Personal Democracy Forum community and worked in a key way as online organizing director for the first Obama campaign. You know him more recently for his work serving as a trustee of the Knight Foundation. And he also has a new project on economic security, the Economic Security Project, which maybe he'll say a little bit about. And I hand it over to you, Chris.
Thank you, Mika. And thanks for everybody for being here. Thanks to Civic Hall and the Knight Foundation for making this event possible. I have had the distinct pleasure of being a trustee of the Knight Foundation now for almost 5 years, which believe it or not, is the longest serving board that I've been on, and it's an incredible organization, and so I'm so honored to be a part of it and to have the opportunity to moderate a conversation with all of these folks today. So we are ending the day with a very big question. What is the future of the First Amendment? And the backdrop, as all of you know, is an increasingly difficult environment in Washington. Certainly this past administration did not meet the expectations of many, failed many people's expectations when it came to the First Amendment and its relationship with the press. But for many people, whether you're on the left or you're on the right, it seems like even darker clouds loom. In addition to that, public opinion is shifting faster than perhaps anyone would have expected even just a few years ago. I know that's been a major topic of conversation today. And distrust in the media is at all-time highs, and millennials in particular are leading the way with their own pessimism when it comes to the media and the media landscape. So, with that, we have an esteemed panel to help us figure out how to navigate these waters. The good news is that I am not a lawyer. The bad news is everybody else up here today is a lawyer. But we have all agreed that we are going to keep our remarks as direct and as concise as possible. Each one of these folks has prepared some introductory remarks and then we're going to move into a conversation ourselves and then bring many of you into it. So let me just introduce each one of you, and then I'll turn it over to Lynn to get us started. On my left is Lynn Oberlander, who is the general counsel at First Look Media, which I'm sure most of you know, publisher of The Intercept, amongst many other projects. After that is Jamil Jeffries, formerly of the ACLU, and is now the founding director at the Knight First Amendment Institute, which is housed at Columbia and an incredibly important burgeoning institution. And then finally, Floyd Abrams, who's senior counsel at Cahill, Gordon, and Rindell. So with that, I'll turn it over to Lynn, if you'll kick us off and give us some of your thoughts on the landscape before we get more specific in the talk.
Right. Thank you, Chris. I'm just delighted to be part of this panel, to be here in this spectacular library, and to be part of this day. So thank you. Without repeating too much, we all know that the election and the incoming administration has had a surfeit of press-related issues, and it has galvanized the public and the media like no other in recent times. I have been, Jamil and I have been at a number of events recently. There have been a lot of discussions about what this means for the press, for the First Amendment, for the public. And I want to start by saying it's actually been incredibly motivating. President-elect Trump, I can still call him President-elect, has shown tremendous hostility to the institutional press and also, of course, to individual journalists. But he is very, very much a creature of the media. And I don't think we can forget that, because I actually don't think the future is going to be quite as bleak as many of us have been saying it. He needs the press. You know that he reads his coverage very closely. And I think that that is really something important to keep in mind. There are, however, substantial risks to press freedom. They include, briefly, lack of access to the White House, limitations on government transparency, even more leak investigations, if such a thing was possible, attempts perhaps to weaken the libel laws, and perhaps an inability to show our great First Amendment, our shining light, to other countries, because perhaps it will be tarnished. One of the greatest risks, I think, at least, to the First Amendment is not what the administration might do, but how President-elect Trump's language and treatment of the press heretofore might spur others across the country to act, local government, local people, individuals who feel like suing. And I think that that's a real risk. But I do think it's also worth noting that many of these possible threats were coming no matter who won the election. The public, I think we've seen over the last couple of years, has grown quite concerned about how their personal information is gathered and used by the government, yes, absolutely, but also by private companies as the citizenry goes around their daily business. The ease with which ostensibly private information can be hacked and dumped for reporters and less benign forces to rifle through has riled America, both Republicans and Democrats. Not just the DNC hacks, right? But the Sony hacks, the hack of Colin Powell's emails. We've had a whole series of hacks which I think have much of the country has been a little upset with how much private information has found its way available, whether it's reported on or it's just available. And I think that it's led to an environment generally that people can individually legitimately ask whether there are any limits on what can be made public. Now, we are all lawyers, and I know everyone here knows this, but you all may or may not know it. There is a Supreme Court case that was decided in 2001 called Bartnicki v. Vopper. I'm trying to keep this very concise because I know nobody wants to hear about court cases. But the Supreme Court then sort of answered the question, and basically the court said that if the media publishes something that was wrongfully gotten, right? Something was stolen, something was improperly recorded, but the media itself didn't do anything wrong they weren't responsible for getting the material, for doing the wrong thing that was just sent to them, perhaps over the transom in an envelope or through Secure Drop. And if it was newsworthy and in the public interest, then the media could not be punished for publishing that true information. And that has been, it's a tremendous, it's a great case. It makes a lot of sense to us. But I think that given what's happened with the emails, you may begin to see some pressure around those cases at the edges. What is in the public interest, perhaps? I'm curious what the co-panelists think, that the holding's gonna go away, but I do think there may be some tension around what constitutes public information and newsworthiness. There's been a lot of discussion about whether Trump can effectively loosen the libel laws, and I actually don't think he can. I think that that's really great law that's been set. And I'm going to read, Every time I give a talk, I'd like to read one of the great quotes from the Supreme Court about the First Amendment. So I apologize, but I think it's incredibly important. In New York Times v. Sullivan, Justice Brennan, which is the one case that constitutionalized defamation law, Brennan wrote, "Thus, we consider this case against the background of a profound national commitment to the principle that debate on public issues should be uninhibited, robust, and wide open, and that it may well include vehement, caustic, and sometimes unpleasantly sharp attacks on government and public officials. I think that we will be returning to these words in the coming months and years." But other changes that I think we might see, the question really was what kind of challenges to the First Amendment. I don't think we're going to see a weakening of the libel laws, but I do think we may see challenges along the lines of what's gone on in Europe. So a rise in the relative importance of privacy or privacy compared to sort of the First Amendment rights of free expression. So as in Europe, as many of you know, there is already an equilibrium between Article 10, freedom of expression, and Article 8, right to privacy, under the European Convention on Human Rights. And I would say an increased appreciation of the reputational risks of having everything easily available on Google. The right to be forgotten, upheld by the European Court of Justice in 2014, has permitted citizens to petition Google and other search engines to delink content that they are no longer happy with, essentially wiping out such information from the public record. I think that there is a big risk that those principles are going to move over to these shores. I mean, there's already been a lot of pressure on little parts of it, on expungement laws for getting rid of people's criminal records, on taking things that were really classically public information, like when you applied for a gun permit or mug shots, and taking them out of the public record. And I think we're going to see more of that happening. I think that was happening anyway, but I think we are going to, that's going to be a pressure point. I'm probably running out of time, right, keeping it snappy?
Just
so,
2 minutes.
2 minutes, all right. So then I will say that we were also asked to talk about the question of social media and what kinds of responsibilities the big platforms might have. Now, Facebook and Google are not, fortunately, government entities, and they are not, therefore, restricted by the First Amendment. And as I'm sure many of you know, Section 230 of the Communications Decency Act gives the platforms an incredibly broad immunity from policing the third-party content that's on their sites, true and untrue. So legally, they actually have very little responsibility for what's there, what other people put on their platforms. But I do think there are, again, some pressure points against Google and Facebook. Certainly public perception, they are very responsive to how they are perceived by the people. And right now, they are also not doing so well. Fake news controversy is only just the latest of challenges to Facebook, et cetera. Consider last spring's discussion over whether terrorists were using their discussion groups to recruit potential jihadists. I think, and I hope, that we will see greater transparency from the social media, from the algorithms. Maybe we'll learn a little bit more about why we're getting certain information, why we're not. I think they'll probably create more tools that individuals can use to mark or flag content that may violate some terms of service. But I do think that all of those things, all of those tools, will come at a cost to the populace. I mean, those are essentially, even if it's not government censorship, it is certainly a restriction at some level of the kind of content available on these platforms. Which leads me, but the platforms are incredibly powerful, right? I mean, they are, not everyone may agree, but they have a commanding presence in how people receive their news. And I think maybe we should be talking about or thinking about the social media platforms as the new town squares, the new malls, where the only restrictions on speech that should be allowed are reasonable time, place, and manner restrictions. I'm just throwing it out there but I do think that we have a real tension with the power of the social media versus, and the way they have control over what conversations are happening, and yet it's in conflict with lots of things, including Section 230. But I do kind of think that they're really equivalent to going to the mall when I was a kid and screaming in the middle, of the fountain.
So I want to come back to this because I think it's an important point that that we need to delve into at depth. But Jamil, if I can turn it over to you to give us some opening thoughts.
Sure, yeah. So first, thank you for inviting me to participate in this. It's great. I share Lynn's trepidation about the incoming administration. Given his record as a candidate, it seems entirely possible to me that President Trump will blaze new paths in harassing and investigating and even prosecuting people for what they say or what they post or what they tweet or what they print. If the Justice Department takes its cues from the president, I suspect we'll see the material support laws stretched even further than they've already been and applied even more aggressively to activity that's protected by the First Amendment. We're now accustomed to seeing the Espionage Act used against whistleblowers, but as Lynn mentioned, we may see it used against the press too. Those laws, the material support laws and the Espionage Act, they sweep very broadly by their terms. And so if the Trump administration wants to criminalize dissent, there's a sense in which they have the tools already at their disposal. More generally, I feel morbidly confident that the concept of national security, which is a concept that's been much abused over the last 15 years, will continue to be exploited to the detriment of the freedoms of speech and the press. Justice Black famously observed in the Pentagon Papers case that the word security is a broad, vague generality that can readily be invoked to, quote, abrogate the fundamental law embodied in the First Amendment. I think that he meant that as a caution or a warning, but I worry that the new administration will read it as an invitation. Some of the most significant threats to the freedom of speech and the press are likely to be more subtle, less visible, indirect. In recent years, Congress has expanded the government's surveillance authority over and over again, even as technological change has made surveillance more intrusive and less costly. The chilling effect of that surveillance is very difficult to measure, but it's very real. There was a study a few years ago, researchers for Human Rights Watch and the ACLU interviewed journalists from major media organizations about the impact of government surveillance on their work. The journalists said that fear of surveillance was dissuading would-be sources from contacting reporters and making existing sources more reticent. Surveillance was, quote, constricting the flow of information concerning government activity. Sources were more reluctant to speak even about matters that were unclassified, but the chilling effect was felt most acutely by journalists who were investigating issues relating to national security and law enforcement and intelligence. I think that overbroad secrecy presents another kind of threat. The media and civil society can be a real check against government abuse. We've seen that again and again. But only if we have access to information about the government's policies and practices. The Obama administration has not been particularly cooperative on that front. The Obama administration withheld key documents about national security policy, releasing them only after a federal appeals court ordered them to. It invoked the state secrets privilege to insulate controversial national security policies from judicial review. Just yesterday, the Obama administration Justice Department issued new guidance instructing federal agencies to construe Freedom of Information Act requests more narrowly, a cynical effort to undermine an important appeals court ruling. And it also, as we all know, prosecuted more whistleblowers than all previous administrations combined. President Obama's decision to commute Chelsea Manning's sentence was, I think, compassionate and even courageous. But it's worth remembering that Manning was charged with aiding the enemy, sentenced to a term of 35 years, and her sentence was commuted only after 7 years imprisonment. She served more time in prison than any whistleblower in U.S. history. I think it's safe to assume that President Trump will be even less transparent and even more hostile to leaks. More hostile to the journalists who report them, and more hostile to the sources and whistleblowers who supply them. Some civil libertarians are harshly criticizing President Obama for his refusal to pardon Edward Snowden, and I think that they're right to criticize. Things will get worse, though. Mike Pompeo, who's likely to be Trump's CIA director, says that Edward Snowden should be executed. So against this background, and this is the last thing I'll say, I think we're going to be very dependent on the courts. Whether the courts are up to the task of protecting individual rights in the context that we now unexpectedly find ourselves in, we'll see. The courts have been extraordinarily deferential to the Obama administration's national security arguments, and I worry that the habit of deference will be difficult to break. In my view, it'll be a disaster if the courts don't approach the new administration's claims very differently than they approached the last administration's claims. It'll be a disaster if they defer as a matter of course. If the government says that national security requires withholding information or imposing gag orders on technology companies or characterizing disclosures to the media as aid and comfort to the enemy, the government should be compelled to explain why. Especially where government policy implicates individual rights, the courts have the responsibility to test the new administration's arguments and assess the evidentiary basis for its factual claims. Trump's administration should be afforded the deference that it earns and no more than that.
Thank you. Floyd?
So we start 2 days from today. Look around the room now so you'll remember today as a day before 2 days from today. We start on a new adventure for the country. And as we try to think of how it's likely to go in terms of freedom of speech and freedom of the press, I think it's worth a few more general observations. One, first, President Trump, I gag, but President Trump will not be the first president to be angry or dismissive of the press. It was Jefferson, after all, who said that even the least informed of the people have learned that nothing that is published in a newspaper is to be believed. And it was Jefferson who, writing to a 17-year-old boy who wrote him a letter saying that he wanted to be a journalist, wrote, "The man who never looks into a newspaper is better informed than one who reads them, inasmuch as he who knows nothing is nearer the truth than one whose mind is filled with falsehoods and errors." Now, it is ludicrous, nothing less, for me to talk about our new president in the same sentence as Jefferson, who, I should say, more than anyone else is responsible for the fact that we have a Bill of Rights at all and that we have a First Amendment at all. And who led the fight against the Alien and Sedition Act of 1798, which was, of course, aimed at his followers. So what should we expect? Who can we look at that is not ludicrous to look at? I had a look back at the Nixon administration. The Nixon, I think, hated the press in a way that, at this moment, President-elect Trump does not. I think that will come, but I don't think he's really there yet. I was struck by reading a letter that Jed Magruder, who worked in the for Bob Haldeman under Richard Nixon, wrote to Haldeman in October 1969, a year after President Nixon took office, dealing with what should we do about the press. He had three ideas. He said, first, we should begin an official monitoring system of television news and commentary as soon as the FCC chairman that they had nominated takes office, because this could empower the administration to threaten broadcasters with non-renewal of their television and radio licenses. Second, he wrote, I'm quoting, we should utilize the antitrust division to investigate various media relating to antitrust violations. And third, we should utilize the Internal Revenue Service as a method to look into the various organizations we are most concerned about. President Nixon did all that and more. We had a vice president then who was out on the hustings speaking, denouncing the press in the strongest, I would say, vilest terms. We had enormous pressure put on the press by the Nixon administration, particularly television. No internet then, of course, but television. Senior executives called in, threatened or semi-threatened if they didn't tone things down in terms of criticism. That's all those years ago, half a century ago. What can we expect of this administration? At best, I think, maybe the sort of Trump-like tit-for-tat with Meryl Streep. The press says something bad, he responds with something bad. I sometimes think that if the Pope says anything bad about our new president, the next tweet will say, first, he's overrated in terms of what he knows about Catholicism. And second, he ought to pay attention to wayward priests and not me, right? Sad, right? That's, problem is, all that's sort of for real. It could be that, the press can be an irritant and maybe he'll just brush them off, tweet them away and the like. But I think it'll be much worse than that, because I think we can predict without knowing what the event will be. That's something unpredictable as to its specifics. Some leak, some offense by the press is more likely than not to so offend the president that he will seek to take steps which would be extremely threatening to any notion of freedom of the press or freedom of speech. And then it will really rest with all of us to somehow coalesce, and it will rest with the press organizations themselves to be prepared to fight back, not to behave the way our large corporations are in the last few days, each announcing how much more money they're about to spend or how many more people they're about to hire. We'll see what really happens on that front. What we know is that it has happened because of fear of this president coming to power and being angry at them, speaking ill of them, calling their market, causing their market to fall and diminish. So it's going to take a lot of work, and it's going to take a great deal of perseverance on the part of the communications industry to resist, because I think it is hard to imagine when one sees the things that irritate, bother, lead the president-elect to say the sort of things he does about the press. That's nothing, nothing compared to what's likely to happen once he's in office. And so it's going to fall to us, and it's going to fall to the journalists, and it's going to fall to the journalistic organizations to really be as rough as possible in response, that when they're threatened, they fight back. When they're maligned, they respond. That they use the courts instead of simply letting the administration, if it chooses to do so, to use the courts. So it's going to be a very busy, active, and dangerous time, and all of us are going to be called upon to engage in a very serious sort of resistance.
So
That was wonderful. Thank you for setting the stage and giving us some context here. So I'd like to go somewhat narrow on a legal question and then zoom out and ask a little bit more about the general trends of the time that we live in. But narrowly, picking up on one of your concerns from decades ago, Floyd, there's been a trend over the past 5 to 10 years in a lot of media organizations to incorporate themselves as 501c3s. So as public charities, think of ProPublica, the Texas Tribune. In fact, if anything, it feels to me like the trend these days is in the media landscape is that if you do serious journalism, you realize that it's not necessarily going to be profitable, and so therefore you choose the not-for-profit route. Historically, one of the concerns was always, well, the only issue is if that 501c3 status can ever be revoked for fear that the IRS could claim partisanship rather than being in the service of the public good. And generally, people weren't so concerned about that. You could imagine, though, a scenario today in which a more active executive branch actually does pursue that. And if they're not able to affect for-profit companies, perhaps they could go to some of these burgeoning institutions that want to call out the administration and really give them a lot of heat, stress, or perhaps even something more existentially threatening through the IRS. Is that something that you guys are concerned about, or how would you advise those folks in the media world who are thinking about being not-for-profits versus being for-profits when they weigh the risks of freedom of speech limitations?
I'm not really up enough on the financial side, except that it's dire, of the media industry to really pass upon an assessment of risk. Obviously, you incorporate as a 501c3, you play by the rules of 501c3, which is very permissive right now, and you run the risk of an unfriendly administration taking steps to change what the law is. That may happen. I'm not prepared to sort of advise them, especially small entities, that they shouldn't go that route in terms of trying to survive. I would say that in the new internet world, it is the smaller entities which are more likely than not to be at risk first. That even though the courts have provided enormous protection of the internet, and rather consistently so, that companies that can't afford real insurance, individuals who have no idea when they speak that they can be sued for libel by billionaires who can put them out of business if they're in it. I think the situation with Gawker is one of the most dangerous and not enough talked about situation in terms of risk to the press, because the press more and more is at financial risk because for all the reasons that our economy leads this to be true and all the reason that new technology leads it to be true, that the large American media institutions, many of them, are at peril for economic reasons. And a libel lawsuit, a big libel lawsuit, a billionaire suing to put them out of business, as occurred in the Gawker case, is very dangerous stuff.
And that sort of begs the question, how do you guys think about or define the press in general? I mean, if a website publishes an illicit sex video, for instance, I mean, any website, what makes it the press and thus worthy of defense versus a blog that is just peddling and illicit material. I mean, these seem like the challenges that the courts would have immediately in front of them and would be a challenge not just from a legal definitional perspective, but when it comes to protecting the rights of journalists for defending against them for the incoming administration or anyone who wants to pursue them.
I mean,
we can speak specifically about Gawker if you'd like, or you can zoom out.
No, I think, listen, blogs are press. Are there, I mean, they are journalists. They can be journalists. I mean, not all of them are, but certainly somebody who has the intention of finding news, reporting news, and publishing it, even if it's an individual, you know, on the second floor, they're covered by the First Amendment in the same way that the New York Times is. And I think the risk, as Floyd's talking about it, is that they don't have the financial resources. And frankly, the big media companies don't have the financial resources anymore to put up a fight. Vis-a-vis sex tapes, you know, I think that the law, I think they would have, talking about Gawker, they would have won on appeal. But they didn't get to an appeal. And that presented the fact that the way that case went, whether that they were just by the size of the judgment and they couldn't bond it. I mean, you can argue about what exactly was going on, but that they couldn't bond it, that you had to put up a $50 million bond just to take an appeal on a jury verdict that had six people on a jury. That is a huge First Amendment problem, regardless of what you think about the content that Gawker posted or published, in my mind. And they were denied their right to an appeal on First Amendment grounds. Their appeal, they weren't denied on First Amendment grounds, but they would have had an appeal on First Amendment grounds. So I think that was, you know, really problematic. I will just say back to your other question on nonprofit stuff. We have looked at this. I mean, the restriction on 501c3s is that you can't endorse a candidate, right? That's pretty clear. But I think Floyd is correct, and you raise a very interesting question that the amount of it's very loose. The regulations of 501c3s have been incredibly lax. And if they were to come after, if the IRS were to try to take away one of, you know, ProPublica's tax-exempt status because they didn't like their coverage, I think that would make a phenomenal case. Like, that would be a great case that I would hope the Knight First Amendment Center would, you know, would take on.
Now, right?
Yeah. So
I think this is sort of a crucial point, and so let me just belabor it. You have to distinguish between the strength of the legal argument and the strength of the entity, right? Because a lot of these organizations, these smaller media organizations, they may have very strong legal claims, right? It's maybe the Trump administration tries to pull, the IRS tries to pull a 501c3 status from one of these organizations, and maybe they have a very strong legal claim that it's viewpoint-based and therefore violates the First Amendment. But you need to have the resources to actually defend yourself or to prosecute one of those cases. And the vast majority of entities that find themselves in these kinds of positions don't have those resources.
This is like the TechDirt example that some of us were
talking
about.
Exactly, TechDirt is a great example of it. But you know, for TechDirt actually, in comparison to many of the, I've talked to many tiny little tech companies that were, that received national security letters. They received these, you know, subpoenas, yeah, essentially, ordering them to disclose information. And they had problems with the demand from the government, or they wanted to challenge the gag order that had been placed on them. But they didn't have the resources to hire lawyers, yeah, to do that. And you know, there's a very short list of organizations that are able and willing to provide legal representation for free. But once you get outside those organizations, you know, you're out of luck. And it's a real problem.
I'm sorry, go on. So I just want to add in response to your question, too, that although the Supreme Court today is, in my view, and other people's, although it's disputed to some extent, one of the most pro-First Amendment courts we've ever had, it is not especially pro-press court or press freedom court. What they've done is basically to expand a good deal of law protecting freedom of speech for everyone. What they haven't done, they haven't had the cases, but they wouldn't do it, I think, is to provide any sort of special protections for the press. So it becomes all the more important for the court, if that is the case, and that may be the best one can hope for the new Supreme Court, for the court to be urged to continue the process of expanding First Amendment free speech rights. So I don't think we're going to have a lot of cases where the issue is going to be, are you a journalist or are you not a journalist? That could come up with confidential sources, but they aren't taking confidential source cases right now anyway. It could come up with access to certain events, but it's not going to come up much. And the real effort, I think, of the First Amendment bar and great new organizations like Jamil's has got to be to keep the pressure on to get broad and broader still protections across the board. So, yes, the internet user at home doesn't have to show he or she is a journalist or does things like journalists do. But an American citizen, American speaker, an American entitled to First Amendment protection.
Great, so I have two more questions and then we're gonna open it up to everyone here. Both of which are sort of about the cultural backdrop of what's happening with the First Amendment and the law these days. There has been a lot of talk about millennials and free speech, particularly on campus these days. And as we all know, millennials are now the largest generation in the United States and have very different free speech attitudes, according to Pew and Gallup and other researchers, than previous generations do. In a Pew survey just from last year, 4 in 10 millennials say the government should be able to prevent people from publicly making statements that are offensive to minority groups. This is double, if not triple, what the rates are in other generations. Do you guys think this is a historic shift? Is something really happening here that is different than other periods? If so, is it permanent and likely to last? And if it is, what can be done about it?
Well, you could teach civics in junior high school again. I mean, there really has to be
a
better job.
You mean that would restore trust in media? Just the civics class?
Really, it's got to be a better job of training kids about what this country is about at its best. And I just don't think that's happening.
Yeah, I don't know if I mean, there have been these very well-publicized incidents in which, you know, people are obviously oversensitive to controversial speech, right? I'm not sure that I see a crisis in campus speech. I do think that there are, you know, we're at a moment where equality issues are at the forefront in a way that they haven't been, you know, certainly since the 1970s, right? And in my view, there are student groups that are making very legitimate demands that are motivated by equality considerations. And some of the backlash, some of the characterization of this crisis of speech on campus is actually a response not to oversensitivity about speech, but to the substantive equality demands. So I want to be very careful about, you know, I don't want to defend, you know, I could list a dozen incidents in which I think students were too sensitive to speech, that they characterized speech as a threat when it was actually just speech they disagreed with. Those instances are easy to find, right? But I think it's too easy to kind of write off what's going on campuses as, you know, a bunch of snowflakes. I don't think it's that simple. I think that there are legitimate equality demands. Students want those demands heard. And at the same time, there is, you know, I think that there's a kind of association, a dangerous association of free speech and reactionary ideas. You know, I think we need to do sort of collectively, people who feel, who are sort of deeply committed to the First Amendment, need to do a better job of making the case that the First Amendment belongs to everybody, that this is something that minority groups should value, if anything, even more than anyone else. I think that collectively we have not made that case very well. So, you know, I don't want to, you know, I definitely don't want to downplay the concerns about oversensitivity. I think that those are, you know, those are legitimate concerns too. But I don't think it's fair to pretend that it's all about, you know, that kind of oversensitivity.
Right. Just to have a little a debate up here, I think your vocabulary is on the tepid side. I don't think it's oversensitivity. We used to call it censorship. And one of the things that's happening, and I agree that there are mixed motives for it, but yeah, one of the things that's happened is that conservative speakers can't get to speak on campus.
Right.
I mean, that's just a reality now. We had a situation at Fordham here a year and a half ago, which the Fordham Republican Club was barred from inviting Ann Coulter to speak. I mean, this is madness, and it's worse. I mean, it really is illustrative of what I think is a much broader problem. I don't disagree with what you said about the other side.
Right. Yeah. No, I think that's right. And oversensitivity is not the right word for that. I think that censorship is the right word. And that's not the only instance. I think that there are many instances like that. So, you know, I don't want to, I think that it's important to focus on those and not to understate the significance of those kinds of events. I just don't want to, you know, I don't think that we should.
We shouldn't damn the whole
generation. Exactly. We shouldn't damn the whole generation because of incidents like that. Sure.
So with one last question, I'll invoke a little bit of moderator's privilege and just weigh in a little bit on this censorship question myself, because I absolutely share the concern that everybody speaks the same, talks the same, and believes the same, or at least that's the risk when you have that kind of censorship. I also really worry about the kind of self-censorship that creeps up in rooms like this. Like, I'm not sure... I'm tempted to ask for if there's a Trump supporter in the room to raise your hand, but I won't because I'm skeptical that there is one, and if so, I don't want to put you on the spot. There was one in the last panel, I know. You're right. The point is like the censorship also has a way of creeping in so that there is no central authority censoring in the way the word is, but instead the tools and the ways that we communicate, and this will bring us back to hopefully one of your first comments, Lynn, create rooms, days, communities, even cities where voices are almost completely silenced. And that happens here, and that happens in the middle of Trump country. And so that's not so much a legal question, but more, for me at least, about the way we value, you know, civil discourse in our country. So it does tie back to the last question I wanted to ask very quickly before we go to everybody else, is around the role of social media. And what extra legal responsibilities do you think, or perhaps they should even be enshrined in the law, that companies like Facebook or Twitter or Instagram, I mean, you could go through a long list, have to guarantee basic free speech. We've all read about these core of people who sort of determine what is acceptable or not on the network, and that is only, I think, going to expand as there are more conversations around misinformation, fake news, misleading news. The more attention that it seems is directed at how to manage these problems means there's more and more of a risk of us taking the responsibility to determine what should be free speech out of the realm of the courts and into the realm of the corporations like Facebook. So I guess, how concerned are you guys about that? And do you think there are, what expectations would you hope to have for the leaders of those companies to make sure that free speech is continued to be a value?
I think that one of the great reasons that we have such and this may not be popular in this audience, but one of the great reasons that we have such trash on the internet and that you even have this discussion about it, you have the trolling, that you have the kind of not safe spaces for people to engage in public discourse on the internet is because of Section 230 of the Communications Decency Act. I mean, I think you could legislatively not touch anything, but you could get rid of the immunity for providers. This is, I'm not saying we should do it because there are costs to it, but you could get rid of
there
the immunity,
framework.
And then people would be like regular old communication. You want to insult somebody, you are liable to be sued for it. And I mean, it plays. I'm not saying that's the solution. I'm just saying that we need to understand that one of the reasons that this has all happened is that we have created a structure where there is no legal recourse, essentially, for people who are harmed by the speech. And so we have, in some ways, created this incredible place for free speech, but without any of the traditional sort of either barriers to entry or deterrence factors. And so I'll just say that.
Yeah. Any other thoughts?
Yeah, I mean, I think that on this issue of it was just, I know it's just a part of your question, but the issue of so-called fake news. To me, both options are bad. You know, the one option is Facebook does nothing, right? And we've seen the results of Facebook doing close to nothing on that, you know, on that particular issue. And it's very hard for people to judge the reliability of particular links that you know, sometimes. False facts get distributed very widely, you know, as the saying goes, before the truth gets its boots on, right? But Facebook doing something is also a bad option, right? You don't want, or at least to me, it's a dangerous thing, the idea of Facebook being the arbiter of what's true and what's false. I actually think that this idea of external fact checkers is presents its own risk, but of the options on the table, it seems like the one that is least dangerous. You know, the idea of Facebook, you know, essentially outsourcing to independent parties the obligation to check facts in some sense, and then the facts aren't actually, you know, censored. But there's a flag of some kind that, you know, indicates the external party's view of those facts. You know, there are some risks with that. Other people have pointed them out. But of the options that have been seriously discussed, to me that seems like the least risky,
least
dangerous,
least bad.
Yeah.
And I think this is an area where the difference between the government and a private company, however large and however powerful, is worth keeping in mind. The First Amendment protects as against the government all sorts of speech, racist speech, threatening speech of almost anything but immediate harm about to occur as a result of the speech itself. I think it's not too much for us to ask of Facebook and its competitors, and I think that they will be inevitably drawn into this to engage in a level of content control, hopefully from the outside, hopefully with a very light touch, but that, for example, their policy, their expressed policy about racist speech, I think is correct. The government couldn't do it. Facebook does it or tries to do it, and I don't see anything inconsistent in that, and I think that they should. Is it dangerous? Sure it is. But I think it's both inevitable and hopefully, ultimately, useful.
Interesting. All right, well, I haven't done a great job of holding time for questions, but we do have just a couple minutes if there are one or two questions out there from the audience.
Thank you. This is a really great panel. So my question is going to sound slightly perverse, but if the government really does crack down, what do you think of the prospects of transnational cooperation or sites like WikiLeaks or something Trumpy leaks, whatever you want to call it, being the safety valve so that we can still get pertinent information out in public view?
See, I view WikiLeaks as a problem, not a solution. So maybe that's too easy for me. Yes, we can import into this country ideas that may be thought too dangerous. But you know, we are the exporter. I mean, we're the exporter of more terrorist pornography, Nazism. I could give a list of things which were impossible before more modern technology and is impossible for good reasons, but impossible to ban. I mean, we are more of a source of Nazi-like propaganda to the world than any place else and all of the world put together. So I don't look to foreign sources to protect us, let alone ones I think are essentially anti-American in their nature.
I'm not sure if I understood the question, but to the extent it was a question about whistleblowers and transparency. So there, I think we're going to be very dependent on whistleblowers under, you know, in a kind of weird way. You know, it's never been a harsher landscape for whistleblowers, notwithstanding the pardon of Chelsea Manning. You know, the landscape for whistleblowers is very bleak. They've never been punished as severely as they're being punished now. It's now routine for the government to use the Espionage Act against even people who leak to the media rather than provide information to some foreign intelligence agency. So it's a bleak landscape for whistleblowers. But on the other hand, you know, with an administration that is promising to be even more secretive than an administration that was quite secretive, and an administration that is already saying that it's going to be even less forthcoming about some of the most important policies, you know, I think we're going to be very dependent on whistleblowers. And I think I've never been a member of the media, but one question I think for the media is, well, what is the media's obligation with respect to those whistleblowers and the defense of those whistleblowers? You know, the Guardian and the Washington Post got a Pulitzer Prize for the reporting about Edward Snowden. What is the obligation of the media organizations that were lauded for their reporting based on the information provided by this particular whistleblower? And you know, there's been a kind of, I think, strategic distance that the media organizations have always cultivated, if that's the right word, between them and the whistleblowers. I wonder if that needs to change in the new world we're entering.
Great. We have one last question.
Hi there. So everybody's worried about the erosion of press freedoms, and as you've discussed, open source documents. What is the strategy for not playing defense and waiting for these things to happen? What should the Washington Post and the New York Times do to challenge these things? And what would your strategy be?
Well, I'm not trying to dodge the question, but even the Trump people haven't done anything yet. I gave a speech to a media group a few months ago and surprised many of them by saying that I thought journalists and journalistic organizations ought to take a hard look at using the libel law to protect themselves in situations in which they are falsely accused and the like in a way which is genuinely harmful and meets all the constitutional tests. I think there will be a limited number of affirmative sort of steps that can be taken. Extra legally, the press can take still more steps to assure that their confidential sources are not easily or comfortably found. Now, the problem there is not a press problem. The problem is a technology problem and a government will problem in terms of, you know, so easy to get travel records now and telephone records and the like, you don't have to call a journalist anymore. So it's going to be difficult, and I'm sorry, I don't have any answers, except that I do think that the press ought to make an effort without just protecting their own, but to have a certain level of fellowship with their profession and the field and the people in it and the people who speak, who are attractive and unattractive and do good and bad things and the like, that they really ought to feel a sense of fellowship, which I think is not often felt.
There are also some affirmative steps that have been going on that we could put a little, we could continue to work on. A federal anti-SLAPP law would provide additional protection. A federal Reporters Shield law, which, Vice President Pence was in fact one of the sponsors of sort of the last go-round. And even though it may or may not, the last time it had a huge hole for national security cases, you could argue that any shield law is better. You could argue, there's difference of opinion, but you could argue that any shield law is going to be better than no shield law, at least for certain cases, at least in the federal court, after the Fourth Circuit decision. There are sort of affirmative legislative things that we could be banding together to work towards. There's also more affirmative access type cases, both FOIA but also state level private records, to think about making good law in terms of some of the information that should be available. So there are smaller things, but Floyd is right, nothing's happened yet.
Can I just add that we almost had a federal shield law, sort of weak but useful, and but for WikiLeaks, we would have one.
Yep. Jamil, any closing thoughts for us?
Yeah, so just less concretely on that question. I think the most important thing, not that these aren't, important ideas, but I think that the most important thing is getting in the right mindset for this new administration. I was interested to hear Floyd use the word resistance in his, in his remarks. But I think there's a kind of, the first time things happen, things will happen incrementally, right? And there's this great line from Justice Jackson's opinion in Barnett, which is the flag salute case from 1942, in which he says, we avoid these ends by avoiding these beginnings. And I think you have to see that first incremental step, not just for what it is in itself, but for what it could become. And in order to do that, you have to be in the right mindset. You have to understand what this administration has proposed to do over time, what its larger goals are, what its larger philosophy is, and you have to understand these seemingly incremental policy changes in that broader context. I think that's really important. And the last thing I'll say is that some of these issues are bigger than the press, and it's important that the press be united on some of them, but it's also important that the press be united with other parts of civil society. And when it comes to issues like equality issues, when it comes to issues that are more structural, transparency issues, or issues relating to conflicts of interest. Some of these issues may not seem to be the natural focus or the kinds of things that the press as a collective would advocate on. But I think that it may be that some of these issues are so important to our democracy and so important to the vitality of the democracy that there needs to be a larger civil society coalition. And I think some of those alliances are already being created now, and I think that's a good thing.
It's a fitting note to end on. So thank you. Thank you, guys.
Thank you so much. My name is John Bracken from Knight Foundation. For those of you who weren't here first thing in the morning, that was what a great way to end the conversation. I just want to say a couple words of thank you. And I also want to, I pay attention to my boss, Chris. I'm lucky enough to be able to call Chris Hughes one of my bosses, or at least one of my bosses of my boss. And so I wanted to go back to something that I mentioned this morning around our emphasis on local. I love New York. My grandparents met here in New York. Both my parents were born in New York. But we're very cognizant that theme of bubbles, that New York does not look like always, and the conversations we're having here in Detroit, here in New York, are different than we might in other cities. So one thing we've been talking about actually leading into this meeting, and the depth and richness of the discussion today has affirmed it for a lot of us. Jennifer, why don't you come up, come back to your stage part. Because this is, we'll get you a hand mic. I just spoke with Katie Locker, who's our representative in Detroit, and just spoke with my colleague in Akron, Ohio, and just got a thumbs up from my colleague Matt Hagman in Miami. So we're going to craft versions of these conversations grounded locally in each of those Knight cities, the cities where Knight Foundation works deeply. So in Akron, Ohio, where we actually started, in Detroit and in Miami later this year as a starting point. And so thank you for giving us that inspiration. If today had gone badly, we wouldn't have had that idea. Jennifer, I don't know if you want to augment that.
Hi, I just wanted to use this opportunity to tell everyone that we have one more day for Knight Foundation's Newsmatch program. So at the end of December, thanks to our Board of Trustees, we got approval for a $1.5 million fund to match donations to 57 not-for-profit news organizations. Most of them are local around the country. And I'm going to tweet out the link so that you can see which one of those 57 news organizations that you would like to donate before the deadline tomorrow night. Local. John Bracken, my colleague, told you our roots began for Knight Foundation in Akron, Ohio, and the focus of the journalism program is very much focused on meeting local information needs. It was just music to our ears to hear in one panel after another about one of the most powerful ways we have to fight fake news, to rebuild and regain trust in journalism, is to focus on meeting local information needs in our communities. So we can get all of your help with that, with the next 24 hours, to use the hashtag Newsmatch. Check it out on the Twitter. I will tweet out the link. At Jennifer Preston is my handle. And please support local news organizations, not-for-profit news organizations across the country. Thanks.
So I need to announce a fund, too. Last week at Knight Foundation, with several other funders, we announced a fund focused on artificial intelligence and its impact on, and the ethics and governance related to it. And I had that discussions that led into that today as I was listening. And what came to mind is the notion of, if we think that the internet has had a disruptive impact on news and information and the way we engage with elections today, you know, the coming role of increased machine intelligence, I think, is going to make what looked like the last 15 years look like a walk in the park. I think the ability for these new tools to alter every aspect of civic society is great. So I would just plant that seed as we begin to sort of get our footing in this new world. The last thing I wanted to say, well, I guess two things. One, for follow-up conversations, if you want to be involved with the Detroit, Akron, or Miami meetings, or anything else, we stood up a Slack instance today using the same hashtag. So it's kfciviccall.slack.com if you want to join the conversation or pitch ideas or talk to us, any of us, about what you want to see come next. And lastly, I really just want to thank Civic Hall and the entire team. This was just a pleasure both intellectually, and it was smooth, and really thank you guys so much. Special thanks to Elena, Tamika, who I think is still outside working, Olivia, Danielle, Chloe, all the volunteers who have been here. Thanks a lot.
Great. Thank you, John. Thank you.
So, besides thanking John and Jen Preston, I just wanted to just really point out that how lucky are we to have the Knight Foundation working to build this field at this particular time in our country's history. I don't know of another organization that's more dedicated to building the field, and so we're very lucky and privileged to be working with them. All of us are. In particular, I want to thank our illustrious team, Danielle, Tomika, and Elena, who are here somewhere. Three people put this thing together very quickly. And I also wanted to highlight Mika Sifri's work, who really curated all of the panels today, and the trust in his ability to pull this together, I rely on greatly, we all rely on greatly. And please come back and get more of it at Personal Democracy Forum, June 8th and 9th. We're gonna continue this conversation. And for those of you who can, please come visit us at Civic Hall. Civichall.org is the website. We're downtown at 22nd Street in the Flatiron District. We're going to continue this conversation every day at Civic Hall for those of you who can come and visit us. And with that, let's have a couple of drinks and celebrate our community and have a few laughs and keep our fingers crossed for Friday. Thank you very much.